This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. A railway electrification system supplies electric power to railway trains and trams without an onboard prime mover or local fuel supply. Electrification has many advantages but requires significant capital expenditure. Selection of an electrification system is based on economics of energy supply, maintenance, and capital cost compared to the revenue obtained for freight and passenger traffic. Different systems are used for urban and intercity areas. Some electric locomotives can switch to different supply voltages to allow flexibility in operation. Contents: 1. Characteristics of railway electrification. 2. Classification. 21. Standardized voltages. 3. Direct current. 31. Overhead systems. 32. Third rail. 33. Fourth rail. 4. Alternating current. 41. Low frequency alternating current. 42. Polyphase alternating current systems. 43. Standard frequency alternating current. 5. World electrification. 6. Comparing electrification systems including future proposals. 61. Energy efficiency, AC versus DC for mainlines. 7. Advantages and disadvantages as compared to diesel traction. 71. Advantages. 72. Disadvantages. 73. Trade-offs. 74. Summary. 75. Energy efficiency. 751. Energy efficiency in the Soviet Union. 76. External cost. 77. Gaps. 78. Capacitor. 8. Non-contact systems. 9. See also. 10. References. 11. Sources. 111. Russian. 112. English. 12. External links. Characteristics of railway electrification. This section needs additional citations for verification. Please help improve this article by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. September 2016. Learn how and when to remove this template message. Electric railways use electric locomotives to haul passengers or freight in separate cars or electric multiple units. Passenger cars with their own motors. Electricity is typically generated in large and relatively efficient generating stations, transmitted to the railway network and distributed to the trains. Some electric railways have their own dedicated generating stations and transmission lines, but most purchase power from an electric utility. The railway usually provides its own distribution lines, switches and transformers. Power is supplied to moving trains with a nearly continuous conductor running along the track that usually takes one of two forms. The first is an overhead line or catenary wire suspended from poles or towers along the track or from structure or tunnel ceilings. Locomotives or multiple units pick up power from the contact wire with pantographs on their roofs that press a conductive strip against it with a spring or air pressure. Examples are described later in this article. The second is a third rail mounted at track level and contacted by a sliding pickup shoe. Both overhead wire and third rail systems usually use the running rails as the return conductor, but some systems use a separate fourth rail for this purpose. In comparison to the principal alternative, the diesel engine, electric railways offer substantially better energy efficiency, lower emissions and lower operating costs. Electric locomotives are usually quieter, more powerful, and more responsive and reliable than diesels. They have no local emissions, an important advantage in tunnels and urban areas. Some electric traction systems provide regenerative braking that turns the train's kinetic energy back into electricity and returns it to the supply system to be used by other trains or the general utility grid. While diesel locomotives burn petroleum, electricity is generated from diverse sources including many that do not produce carbon dioxide, such as nuclear power and renewable forms including hydroelectric, geothermal, wind and solar. Disadvantages of electric traction include high capital costs that may be uneconomic on lightly trafficked routes, a relative lack of flexibility since electric trains need electrified tracks or onboard supercapacitors and charging infrastructure at stations, and a vulnerability to power interruptions. Different regions may use different supply voltages and frequencies, complicating through service and requiring greater complexity of locomotive power. The limited clearances available under catenaries may preclude efficient double-stack container service. Possible lethal electric current due to risk of contact with high-voltage contact wire and third rails is a safety hazard to track workers, passengers and trespassers. Overhead wires are safer than third rails, but they are often considered unsightly. Classification: electrification systems in Europe. Electrification systems are classified by three main parameters: voltage current, direct current DC, alternating current AC, frequency contact system, third rail, fourth rail, overhead line, catenary, standardized voltages. Six of the most commonly used voltages have been selected for European and international standardization. These are independent of the contact system used, so that, for example, 750. The permissible range of voltages allowed for the standardized voltages is as stated in standards BS 512. Rapid transit subways and trams speed was controlled by connecting the traction motors in various series parallel combinations, by varying the traction motors' fields, and by inserting and removing starting resistances to limit motor current. Motors have very little room for electrical insulation, so they generally have low voltage ratings, because transformers prior to the development of power electronics cannot step down DC voltages. Trains were supplied with a relatively low DC voltage that the motors can use directly. The most common DC voltage are listed in the previous section. Third and fourth rail systems almost always use voltages below 1. Supply cables, wires, and closely spaced converter stations. The distance between feeder stations on a 750. Complexity has made single-phase standard practice despite the interruption in power flow that occurs twice every cycle. An experimental 6 kV DC railway was built in the Soviet Union. The increasing availability of high-voltage semiconductors may allow the use of higher and more efficient DC voltages that heretofore have only been practical with AC. Some DC locomotives used motor generator sets as step-down transformers to produce more convenient voltages for auxiliary loads such as lighting, fans, and compressors. But they are inefficient, noisy, and unreliable. Solid-state converters have replaced them. State-of-the-art locomotives, diesel-electric as well as electric, have even replaced the traditional universal-type traction motor with a three-phase AC induction motor driven by a special-purpose AC inverter. A variable-frequency drive overhead systems class EM1 locos on the 1500. Zeeland Wellington and the United States Chicago area on the Metra Electric District and the South Shore Line Interurban Line in Slovakia. There are two narrow gauge lines in the High Tatras, one a cog railway in Portugal. It is used in the Cascais Line and in Denmark on the Suburban S train system in the United Kingdom. 1500. Third rail main article, third rail a bottom contact third rail on the Amsterdam Metro. The Netherlands most electrification systems use overhead wires, but third rail is an option up to about 1200. The end of a section of power rail DC systems, especially third rail systems, are limited to relatively low voltages, and this can limit the size and speed of trains and cannot use low-level platform and also limit the amount of air conditioning that the trains can provide. This may be a factor favoring overhead wires and high-voltage AC, even for urban usage. In practice, the top speed of trains on third rail systems is limited to 100. The disadvantage of conduit collection included much higher initial installation costs, higher maintenance costs, and problems with leaves and snow getting in the slot. For this reason, in Washington, D.C., cars on some lines converted to overhead wire on leaving the city center. A worker in a plow pit disconnecting the plow while another raised the trolley pole hitherto hooked down to the roof to the overhead wire in New York City for the same reasons of cost and operating efficiency. Outside of Manhattan, overhead wire was used. A similar system of change over from conduit to overhead wire was also used on the London tramways, notably on the southern side. A typical changeover point was at Norwood, where the conduit snaked sideways from between the running rails, to provide a park for detached shoes or plows. A new approach to avoiding overhead wires is taken by the second-generation tram-streetcar system in Bordeaux, France. Entry into service of the first line in December 2003, original system discontinued in 1958 with its APS alimentation parcel, ground current feed. This involves a third rail which is flush with the surface like the tops of the running rails. The circuit is divided into segments with each segment energized in turn by sensors from the car as it passes over it, the remainder of the third rail remaining dead since each energized segment is completely covered by the lengthy articulated cars, and goes dead before being uncovered by the passage of the vehicle. There is no danger to pedestrians. This system has also been adopted in some sections of the new tram systems in Reims, France. Opened 2011 and Angers, France also opened 2011. Proposals are in place for a number of other new services including Dubai, UAE, Barcelona, Spain, Florence, Italy, Marseille, France, Gold Coast, Australia, Washington DC, USA, Brasilia, Brazil and Tours, France. Fourth rail. The unprotected third rail is at the right of the track and the fourth rail at the centre. London Underground track at Ealing Common on the District Line, showing the third and fourth rails beside and between the running rails. The London Underground in London is one of the few networks that uses a four-rail system. The additional rail carries the electrical return that, on third rail and overhead networks, is provided by the running rails on the London Underground. A top contact third rail is beside the track, energized at 7 quintillion 2 quadrillion 420 trillion spade suit 420. Cause electrolytic damage and even arcing if the tunnel segments are not electrically bonded together. The problem was exacerbated because the return current also had a tendency to flow through nearby iron pipes forming the water and gas mains. Some of these, particularly Victorian mains that predated London's underground railways, were not constructed to carry currents and had no adequate electrical bonding between pipe segments. The four rail system solves the problem. Although the supply has an artificially created earth point, this connection is derived by using resistors, which ensures that stray earth currents are kept to manageable levels. Power only rails can be mounted on strongly insulating ceramic chairs to minimize current leak, but this is not possible for running rails, which have to be seated on stronger metal chairs to carry the weight of trains. However, elastomeric rubber pads placed between the rails and chairs can now solve part of the problem by insulating the running rails from the current return should there be a leakage through the running rails on tracks that London Underground share with National Rail. Third rail stock. The Bakerloo and District Lines both have such sections. The center rail is connected to the running rails, allowing both types of train to operate, at a compromise voltage of 660. Three rail system. To simplify rolling stock use fourth rail. Trains occasionally operate on the national third rail system. To do so, the center rail shoes are bonded to the wheels. This bonding must be removed before operating again on fourth rail tracks, to avoid creating a short circuit bogey from an MP89 Paris Metro rolling stock. The lateral contact shoe is located between the rubber tires. The bogey of an MP05, showing the flanged steel wheel inside the rubber tired one, as well as the vertical contact shoe on top of the steel rail. A few lines of the Paris Metro in France operate on a four-rail power scheme because they move on rubber tires which run on a pair of narrow rollways made of steel and, in some places, concrete. Since the tires do not conduct the return current, the two guide bars provided outside the running rollways double up as third rails, so at least electrically it is a four-rail scheme. Each wheel set of a powered truck carries one traction motor. A side sliding side running contact shoe picks up the current from the vertical face of each guide bar and individually feeds one traction motor on each truck. The return of each traction motor, as well as each wagon, is effected by one contact shoe each that slide on top of each one of the running rails. The Montreal Metro and all other rubber-tired metros that have a 1435. Same manner. Alternating current railways and electrical utilities use AC for the same reason, to use transformers, which require AC, to produce higher voltages. Power is voltage times current, so the higher the voltage, the lower the current. For the same power, lower current means lower line loss and or the ability to use lighter and less expensive conductors, because in electric railroading the use of AC implies very high voltages. It is only used on overhead wires, never on third rails inside the locomotive. Another transformer steps the voltage down for use by the traction motors and auxiliary loads. An early advantage of AC is that the power wasting resistors used in DC locomotives for speed control were not needed in an AC locomotive. Multiple taps on the transformer can supply a range of voltages. Separate low voltage transformer windings supply lighting and the motors driving auxiliary machinery. More recently, the development of very high power semiconductors has caused the classic universal AC-DC motor to be largely replaced with the three-phase induction motor fed by a variable frequency drive, a special inverter that varies both frequency and voltage to control motor speed. These drives can run equally well on DC or AC of any frequency, and many modern electric locomotives are designed to handle different supply voltages and frequencies to simplify cross-border operation. Low frequency alternating current. 15. From the grid supply. High voltage AC overhead systems are not only for standard gauge national networks. The meter gauge Rhaetian Railway RHB and the neighboring Matterhorn Gothard Bonn MGB operate on 11 kV at 167. Fed at 24. Switzerland 1899, and the lines of the Ferrovia Alta Valtellina from Colico to Chiavenna and Torino in Italy, which were electrified in 1901 and 1902. Other lines where the three-phase system were used were the Simplon Tunnel in Switzerland from 1906 to 1930, and the Cascade Tunnel of the Great Northern Railway in the United States from 1909 to 1927. The early systems used a low-frequency 16. Workers electrifying parts of the Roca line in Buenos Aires using 25 kV electrification only in the 1950s after development in France 20. Induction traction motors. This system is quite economical, but it has its drawbacks. The phases of the external power system are loaded unequally and there is significant electromagnetic interference generated as well as significant acoustic noise. A list of the countries using the 25. Usually consist of an earth section of wire which is separated from the live wires on either side by insulating material, typically ceramic beads, designed so that the pantograph will smoothly run from one section to the other. The earth section prevents an arc being drawn from one live section to the other, as the voltage difference may be higher than the normal system voltage if the live sections are on different phases, and the protective circuit breakers may not be able to safely interrupt the considerable current that would flow to prevent the risk of an arc being drawn across from one section of wire to earth. When passing through the neutral section, the train must be coasting and the circuit breakers must be open in many cases. This is done manually by the drivers to help them. A warning board is provided just before both the neutral section and an advance warning some distance before. A further board is then provided after the neutral section to tell drivers to re-close the circuit breaker, although drivers must not do this until the rear pantograph has passed this board. In the UK, a system known as automatic power control APC automatically opens and closes the circuit breaker, this being achieved by using sets of permanent magnets alongside the track communicating with a detector on the train. The only action needed by the driver is to shut off power and coast, and therefore warning boards are still provided at and on the approach to neutral sections on French high-speed rail lines, the UK high-speed one-channel tunnel rail link, and in the channel tunnel, neutral sections are negotiated automatically. In Japanese Shinkansen lines, there are ground-operated switched sections installed instead of neutral sections. The sections detect trains running within the section and automatically switch the power supply in 03S, which eliminates the need to shut off power at any time. World electrification in 2006, 240,000. Same task, converting and transporting high-voltage AC from the power grid to low-voltage DC in the locomotive. Where should this conversion take place and at what voltage and current, AC or DC, should the power flow to the locomotive, and how does all this relate to energy efficiency? Both the transmission and conversion of electric energy involve losses, ohmic losses in wires and power electronics, magnetic field losses in transformers and smoothing reactors. Inductors. Power conversion for a DC system takes place mainly in a railway substation where large, heavy, and more efficient hardware can be used, as compared to an AC system where conversion takes place aboard the locomotive where space is limited and losses are significantly higher. Also, the energy used to blow air to cool transformers, power electronics including rectifiers, and other conversion hardware must be accounted for. In the Soviet Union, in the 1970s, a comparison was made between systems electrified at 3 kV DC and 25 kV AC 50. The USSR's power grid to lower voltage DC, the conversions for the DC system all took place at higher efficiency in the railway substation, while most of the conversion for the AC system took place inside the locomotive at lower efficiency. Consider also that it takes energy to constantly move this mobile conversion hardware over the rails, while the stationary hardware in the railway substation doesn't incur this energy cost. For more details, see Wiki, Soviet Union DC versus AC advantages and disadvantages as compared to diesel traction. This article contains a pro and con list, which is sometimes inappropriate. Please help improve it by integrating both sides into a more neutral presentation, or remove this template if you feel that such a list is appropriate for this article. June 2014. Advantages. The Royal Border Bridge in England, a protected monument adding electric catenary to older structures, may be an expensive cost of electrification projects. Lower cost of building, running and maintaining locomotives and multiple units. Higher power to weight ratio. No onboard fuel tanks, resulting in fewer locomotives. Faster acceleration. Higher practical limit of power, higher limit of speed, less noise pollution, quieter operation, faster acceleration, clears lines more quickly to run more trains on the track in urban rail uses, reduced power loss at higher altitudes for power loss, see diesel engine, independence of running costs from fluctuating fuel prices, service to underground stations where diesel trains cannot operate for safety reasons, reduced environmental pollution, especially in highly populated urban areas, even if electricity is produced by fossil fuels, easily accommodates kinetic energy brake reclaim using supercapacitors, more comfortable ride on multiple units as trains have no underfloor diesel engines, somewhat higher energy efficiency in part due to regenerative braking and less power lost when idling, can use coal, nuclear, water or wind as the primary energy source instead of oil, historically mattered for e.g. South Africa. Newly electrified lines often show a sparks effect, whereby electrification in passenger rail systems leads to significant jumps in patronage, revenue. The reasons may include electric trains being seen as more modern and attractive to ride, faster and smoother service, and the fact that electrification often goes hand in hand with a general infrastructure and rolling stock overhaul, replacement, which leads to better service quality in a way that theoretically could also be achieved by doing similar upgrades yet without electrification. Whatever the causes of the sparks effect, it is well established for numerous routes that have electrified over decades. Disadvantages. Disadvantages include, large cargo may require special cars. Most overhead electrifications do not allow sufficient clearance for a double stack car. Electrification cost. Electrification requires an entire new infrastructure to be built around the existing tracks at a significant cost. Costs are especially high when tunnels, bridges and other obstructions have to be altered for clearance. Another aspect that can raise the cost of electrification are the alterations or upgrades to railway signaling needed for new traffic characteristics, and to protect signaling circuitry and track circuits from interference by traction. Current electrification may require line closures while the new equipment is being installed. Electrical grid load. Adding a major new consumer of electricity can have adverse effects on the electrical grid and may necessitate an increase in the grid's power output. However, a railway can be electrified in such manner that it has a closed and independent electrical network of its own and backup power available if the national or state electrical grid suffers from downtime. Appearance. The overhead line structures and cabling can have a significant landscape impact compared with a non-electrified or third rail electrified line that has only occasional signaling equipment above ground level. Fragility and vulnerability. Overhead electrification systems can suffer severe disruption due to minor mechanical faults or the effects of high winds causing the pantograph of a moving train to become entangled with the catenary, ripping the wires from their supports. The damage is often not limited to the supply to one track, but extends to those for adjacent tracks as well, causing the entire route to be blocked for a considerable time. Third rail systems can suffer disruption in cold weather due to ice forming on the conductor. Rail theft, the high scrap value of copper and the unguarded, remote installations make overhead cables an attractive target for scrap metal thieves. Attempts at theft of live 25 kV cables may end in the thief's death from electrocution. In the UK, cable theft is claimed to be one of the biggest sources of delay and disruption to train services. People may climb onto standing train cars, and some are seriously hurt or killed when they come too close to the overhead contact line. Birds may perch on parts with different charges, and animals may also touch the electrification system. Animals fall into the ground or fetched by foxes or other predators in most of the world's railway networks. The height clearance of overhead electrical lines is not sufficient for a double-stack container car. Trade-offs. Lots Road Power Station. In a poster from 1910, this private power station, used by London Underground, gave London trains and trams a power supply independent from the main power network. Maintenance costs of the lines may be increased, but many systems claim lower costs due to reduced wear and tear from lighter rolling stock. There are some additional maintenance costs associated with the electrical equipment around the track, such as power substations and the catenary wire itself, but, if there is sufficient traffic, the reduced track and especially the lower engine maintenance and running costs exceed the costs of this maintenance significantly. Network effects are a large factor with electrification when converting lines to electric. The connections with other lines must be considered. Some electrifications have subsequently been removed because of the through traffic to non-electrified lines. If through traffic is to have any benefit, time-consuming engine switches must occur to make such connections, or expensive dual-mode engines must be used. This is mostly an issue for long-distance trips, but many lines come to be dominated by through traffic from long-haul freight trains, usually running coal, ore, or containers to or from ports. In theory, these trains could enjoy dramatic savings through electrification, but it can be too costly to extend electrification to isolated areas, and unless an entire network is electrified, companies often find that they need to continue use of diesel trains even if sections are electrified. The increasing demand for container traffic, which is more efficient when utilizing the double stack car, also has network effect issues with existing electrifications due to insufficient clearance of overhead electrical lines for these trains, but electrification can be built or modified to have sufficient clearance, at additional cost. Additionally, there are issues of connections between different electrical services, particularly connecting intercity lines with sections electrified for commuter traffic, but also between commuter lines built to different standards. This can cause electrification of certain connections to be very expensive simply because of the implications on the sections it is connecting. Many lines have come to be overlaid with multiple electrification standards for different trains to avoid having to replace the existing rolling stock on those lines. Obviously, this requires that the economics of a particular connection must be more compelling, and this has prevented complete electrification of many lines in a few cases. There are diesel trains running along completely electrified routes, and this can be due to incompatibility of electrification standards along the route. Summary of advantages and disadvantages. Lines with low frequency of traffic may not be feasible for electrification, especially using regenerative braking, because lower running cost of trains may be outweighed by the high cost of the electrification infrastructure. Therefore, most long-distance lines in developing or sparsely populated countries are not electrified due to relatively low frequency of trains. Electric locomotives may easily be constructed with greater power output than most diesel locomotives for passenger operation. It is possible to provide enough power with diesel engines, e.g. ICE-TD, but, at higher speeds, this proves costly and impractical. Therefore, almost all high-speed trains are electric. The high power of electric locomotives gives them the ability to pull freight at higher speed over gradients. In mixed traffic conditions, this increases capacity when the time between trains can be decreased. The higher power of electric locomotives and an electrification can also be a cheaper alternative to a new and less steep railway if trains' weights are to be increased. On a system energy efficiency and early rail electrification substation at Dartford in England, UK, electric trains need not carry the weight of prime movers, transmission and fuel. This is partly offset by the weight of electrical equipment. Regenerative braking returns power to the electrification system so that it may be used elsewhere, by other trains on the same system, or returned to the general power grid. This is especially useful in mountainous areas where heavily loaded trains must descend long grades. Central station electricity can often be generated with higher efficiency than a mobile engine generator. While the efficiency of power plant generation and diesel locomotive generation are roughly the same in the nominal regime, diesel motors decrease in efficiency in non-nominal regimes at low power, while if an electric power plant needs to generate less power, it will shut down its least efficient generators, thereby increasing efficiency. The electric train can save energy as compared to diesel by regenerative braking and by not needing to consume energy by idling as diesel locomotives do when stopped or coasting. However, electric rolling stock may run cooling blowers when stopped or coasting, thus consuming energy. Large fossil fuel power stations operate at high efficiency, and can be used for district heating or to produce district cooling, leading to a higher total efficiency. Energy sources unsuitable for mobile power plants, such as nuclear power, renewable hydroelectricity, or wind power, can be used according to widely accepted global energy reserve statistics. The reserves of liquid fuel are much less than gas and coal at 42, 167 and 416 years respectively. Most countries with large rail networks do not have significant oil reserves, and those that did, like the United States and Britain, have exhausted much of their reserves and have suffered declining oil output for decades. Therefore, there is also a strong economic incentive to substitute other fuels for oil. Rail electrification is often considered an important route towards consumption pattern reform. However, there are no reliable, peer-reviewed studies available to assist in rational public debate on this critical issue. Although there are untranslated Soviet studies from the 1980s, energy efficiency in the Soviet Union, in the former Soviet Union, electric traction available eventually became somewhat more energy efficient than diesel, partly due to inefficient generation of electricity in the USSR. Only 208% thermal efficiency in 1950 versus 362% in 1975. In 1950, diesel traction was about twice as energy efficient as electric traction in terms of net ton km of freight per kilogram of fuel, but as efficiency of electricity generation and thus of electric traction improved. By about 1965, electric railways became more efficient than diesel after the mid-1970s electrics used about 25% less fuel per ton km. However, diesels were mainly used on single track lines with a fair amount of traffic, so that the lower fuel consumption of electrics may be in part due to better operating conditions on electrified lines, such as double tracking, rather than inherent energy efficiency. Nevertheless, the cost of diesel fuel was about 15 times more per unit of heat energy content than that of the fuel used in electric power plants that generated electricity, thus making electric railways even more energy cost effective. Besides increased efficiency of power plants, there was an increase in efficiency between 1950 and 1973 of the railway utilization of this electricity, with energy intensity dropping from 218 to 124 kWh, 10,000 gross ton km of both passenger and freight trains, or a 43% drop. Since energy intensity is the inverse of energy efficiency, it drops as efficiency goes up, but most of this 43% decrease in energy intensity also benefited diesel traction. The conversion of wheel bearings from plane to roller, increase of train weight, converting single track lines to double track or partially double track, and the elimination of obsolete two-axle freight cars increased the energy efficiency of all types of traction, electric, diesel, and steam. However, there remained a 12-15% reduction of energy intensity that only benefited electric traction and not diesel. This was due to improvements in locomotives, more widespread use of regenerative braking, which in 1989 recycled 265% of the electric energy used for traction, remote control of substations, better handling of the locomotive by the